5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister. The look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better.
Sir?
Gina!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. I want to welcome Mo. And Mo's actually from Texas. He was one of the gentlemen that was down there that was kind enough to show me and Shannon and the rest of us around. And he's the guy I was mentioning earlier on last Sunday's show about being MacGyver. You know, if you need anything, he's like, he does research and development right there on site, and he'll create whatever you need, or he will, he's the guy that prepared for everything, you know, prepared for anything and everything. And cooks like a chef, but I want to welcome you to the show, Mo.
Hey, thanks for having me, Wes. Good to be here, man.
Yeah, thanks for coming on, man. How are you tonight?
I'm doing well, man. Doing well. You know, I got, I don't know if you know this or not, but I'm an entertainer at night. On the weekends, I do public speaking. So I pretty much work 7 days a week, but that's all going to change here within the next month or so. So I'm pretty psyched, and you know, I'm doing well.
Yeah, you know, you are. Shannon was playing some of your impersonations and songs that you do, and I was like, wow, this guy has a great voice. And then when we got out there, I think I told you, I'm not huge on Bigfoot calls, but some of the calls that you did, I mean, there was times where I was almost reaching for my gun. I was like, wow, that was terrifying. And it's funny because we were all talking about it after the trip. For people who don't know, Mo does a growl, and I think I even told you it was a lot like the growl I heard. No, didn't quite have the power that I heard, but it was close, man. It was really, really close. And the different calls that you do, I was just shocked by. I was like, wow, that would and I won't make you do them on air, but I was impressed by it. I was like, man, I wish I had that baritone that you have in your voice, that deepness in your voice, and could mimic some of the things, you know, even like your owl. I mean, that would throw me off in the forest if I heard that. I would think, well, that's an owl. But I wanted to ask you, Mo, what, and I absolutely hate this question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. How did you actually get into doing Sasquatch research? How did you actually... Was it in any, I know we talked about some of your encounters, but was it in an encounter that brought you into this field, or did you have an interest before then?
Back in the Cumberland Mountains years ago, before I left Maryland to come to Houston, me and a buddy, I took my RV out there. We went on a fishing trip, and he went ahead and he left early. I stayed another night, so I was by myself, and all the campers left. I was walking around the lake, I had my little radio with me, pretty powerful, and just it was nighttime, you know, and I shut the radio off, put it up on top of a fork of a tree, and just sat there and just wanted to listen to the sound because, you know, I'm a kid of the woods. I grew up, you know, in the woods all my life, trapping with my older brother, Matt. So I just wanted to sit there and just chill out. And I wasn't expecting what I got. And I got three vocalizations, one behind me, then one to the left, and then one to the right. Two of the vocalizations were like, sounded like, a woman screaming, very high pitch, very, just like a whale, you know, wailing, screaming. And then behind me, what I did that night for you, that's the first time I heard it, was that night in the Cumberland Mountains. And I tell you right now, Wes, I ran down, got my boombox, and I walked all the way back with my flashlight to the RV, got my RV, and left that very night. I wasn't even going to stay because, like I said, been in the woods all my life, I never heard anything like that. And it just scared the hell out of me. So I forgot about that for years, okay? So here it is about 2011, and I take my children to the Big Thicket. Now, this is the Big Thicket in Coons, Texas, not where we normally go. And long story short, we're out on the trails there, and me and my son pull out our slingshots. We're having fun shooting, you know, stuffed in a little creek there, a little waterway. Even my daughter comes up, and she wants to shoot a little bit, and we're having fun, getting a laugh, having a good old time. And kids are starting to get a bit up on mosquitoes. So I told them to go get some bug spray. And as they left, I'm still shooting. I get like a shot off, and then something catches my eye to the left. And I turn, I look at it, and I was in shock what I saw. I saw a creature with massive shoulders. And I mean, I'm talking humongous shoulders. I did see one arm, and the arms were very, very long. But what this thing did was, it was kind of creepy. It really creeped me out what it did. I guess it saw that I saw it, and it was by a forked tree. I could barely see its head because it put its head, like, by the tree there, one of the forks of the tree, and it brought its arms in towards its body, like in towards its torso. And it starts walking backwards. And it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon, about that time. And the sun was out. And what I saw was the shoulders and this thing just walking backwards. And I saw skin underneath the hair. The hair wasn't terribly long. I mean, it wasn't terribly short, but it wasn't like, you know, really long. And it just, as it walked backwards, I could see the legs. And I could see the shoulders, and it was like it was gliding. Just, there was no bobbing, you know, going up and down. It was just gliding backwards, walking ever so slowly, and then it walks it backwards into the brush, and the brush just goes right over top of it, and it's gone. That's what got me into it. I immediately contacted somebody, told them my story, and described, you know, everything, and you know, he said, yeah, you definitely saw a Sasquatch. You saw a Texas Sasquatch. Now, this thing wasn't, you know, 9 feet tall, 10 feet tall. It wasn't terribly huge. I would say it was well over 7 feet tall. I will say that much. But that's what got me into it, Wes. Ever since that encounter, scared the living hell out of me because my children were there. And that's what really scared me. My kids were there. But I don't know, that's what got me into it. I hooked up with Bob, eventually with Bob Garrett, who was introduced by a mutual friend to Bob. And Bob and I hit it off. I mean, he didn't know me from Adam. Bob didn't know who I was. had no idea. And he met me one day, and we went out, and we just hit it off from that day forward. And, you know, here I am doing this research.
Yeah, isn't it interesting when you have an encounter? I remember when we were sitting around the campfire and you were telling the story. It's interesting when you hear someone recount a story, they go back into the moment. And that's one of the things Shannon was saying. That's one of the things Mimi was saying as you were telling the story. I remember they both said, especially Mimi, because she's not really into this. She said, you know, when I was hearing Mo and kind of watching Mo as he was recounting that story, you could tell that he went back into that moment of when he saw that. You know, you could just see it in his face when he was recounting the story. I wanted to ask you, how far away do you think you were from it when you saw it pop up?
Well, it was across the stream there. Well, I wouldn't call it. I guess I call it a stream. I mean, I'm from PA. We have streams. That's what we call them. It was across the stream. I would say no more than 50 yards. I mean, I can only approximate for you. I can't give you an exact, but I'll say about 50 yards. And I got a really, really good look at it. I mean, like I said, I saw the skin under these massive shoulders. You know,
can you describe the face at all?
Well, I really didn't get a look at the face so much. I saw the head for maybe a second. But it was positioning itself behind this forked tree. I mean, it was strategically trying to hide from me. I mean, it knew what it was doing. And I felt at that moment when I was looking at it and it was checking me out that it knew that I saw it. It knew, because I was just staring right at it. And, you know, when you hear that people describe the hair on the back of your neck, well, the hair on my arms was just standing on end. I was frightened, dude. I'll be honest with you. I was really frightened. I turned around and I walked down and I told the kids, let's go. We're going to go to, we're going to go to this next spot here and check this out. Hit us up at the map here, blah, blah. I was really, really nervous and just, you can understand that.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you. You know, especially if your kids are there.
I wouldn't stay around and just, and call them up. Hey, look what I see. No, I bet to this day, they don't even know. Okay. They just don't even know.
Yeah. It's interesting. Your encounter reminds me of, and it's interesting the behavior that you describe. I've heard that before. There's another gentleman that I talked to who almost describes the identical type of behavior. He didn't want to come on the air, but him and I talked for a while, and he said as he was entering or coming around this bend, he was out hunting. One had stepped out, and he was face to face with it, and it had a surprised look on its face, and he said it backed up. And it's like the forest swallowed it as it was backing up. Like it didn't turn its back on him, but it backed up and just kind of like it was trying to get small and let the forest just kind of come around it, you know. And it sounds like that's kind of what happened with your encounter.
Well, you said swallowed. That's a good way of putting it. Like it's just like swallowed or enveloped it, you know. It just and it was gone. I mean, it was out of sight. So that's a good way to describe it. I didn't realize that you had somebody else have that kind of encounter, because I tell people that, they're like, really? I'm like, yeah, really.
Yeah, and it's exactly the way he described it too. He said it had a surprised look on its face, and it kind of put its arms down and then backed up, and then it's almost like the forest swallowed it. He said it stepped back until it was out of sight and it was gone. I want to ask you, do you think that the creature was there prior to you guys arriving, or do you think it kind of came in to get a good look at you guys? What was your impression? I know you may not know, but what was your impression?
My impression is that it was there. It was watching. That's my impression. And it was, and you know that feeling you get, you know, that feeling like something's watching you. I mean, we're having fun, I'm having fun with the kids and everything, but I mean, looking back on it, I would have seen it come. Well, I don't know. Maybe I wouldn't have seen it come in if they're that stealthy. But my feeling is this. This is my feeling. This is, I think that it was there. It was just, you know, I mean, we weren't there for a long period of time, you know, playing with our slingshots, you know, plunking stuff into the water. I mean, maybe 5 minutes we were there. And, you know, so I guess my feeling is it was there. It was just, it was sitting there watching us. I don't think it, I mean, I could be wrong, but all I know is I caught it. And it knew that I saw it, and it just scared the living crap out of me, dude.
And yeah.
I mean, I'll never want to experience that again. Now, one thing I would like to experience would be maybe a road crossing, you know, to see it in my vehicle, safe in my vehicle, and see it cross the road in full stride and see it, you know, how it, its mechanics and all that, how it moves, but I would never want to come across that again.
Yeah, especially, I would imagine, with your kids. What did you do after the encounter?
Basically, that's it. We're packing up. We're going back to the car. And they're like, Dad, why? We just got here. I'm like, well, we're gonna pack it up and let's go get something to eat. You know, maybe head back a little early to do something else. And
yeah.
The kids were like, wondering why. I just didn't want to be there, man. You know, and the hike back to the vehicle wasn't like it was 2 miles. It was about maybe, you know, mile and a half, maybe a mile, something like that. But it was quick. It was a quick walk. I kept telling the kids, come on, let's go. Let's pull around to Dallion, let's go. And my spouse was looking at me like, you know, what's wrong with you? You're Mr. Forest guy. Something's wrong. And I never told her. She didn't even know. Shortly after that, I think the Finding Bigfoot series came on, and I was like, wow, isn't this cool? You know, look at this. This is interesting. And, you know, I started watching it and got interested in it. And I was sort of in the camp that they're in, that, you know, maybe these things, you know, are benevolent. You know, maybe they're just, you know, maybe they're just watching my kids, just to get a look at them. They were curiosity, blah, blah, blah. I sort of was like, you know, had mixed feelings about it. Maybe I was wrong. Maybe these things aren't out to get my kids or whatever. And I was sort of, you know, thinking that's a possibility. And then I'm not in that camp now. I don't believe that ever since some of the things that's happened here in East Texas, some of the encounters that I've had that are, you know, the branches being thrown at you, the growl that you get when you get too close, and a lot of the stories that I now know about, that, you know, when it comes to people and their encounters here in East Texas. So,
well, do this for the audience, because I don't think, you know, I was down in East Texas, and I didn't realize how much of a Jurassic Park is going on down there. And it's not, you know, I realize for you guys, you know, the week that we were down there, it may not have been, I can't even imagine half the stuff you guys go through, but, cause you know, I was like, you guys were like, well, this is nothing. And I'm like, nothing. That's freaking Jurassic Park around here, man. Things are going off, stuff I hear. I mean, I was blown away when I was down there. And it was night after night. There wasn't one night that we weren't there that we heard, that we didn't hear anything. And I don't mean just anything. I mean, some of the vocals we heard, everyone by the end of the week was completely terrified to be in that area where you guys had taken us. I mean, my whole group was like, we got to get, I'm so happy to go home because this place is crazy. But talk about some of the encounters that you've had since then. I know that was your main sighting. But what are some of the things that you experience while you're out researching and looking into some of these areas?
Well, one, you know, this one instance was pretty terrifying, and I was with Brandon at the time. Bob was back in the vehicle, and he was just, you know, he was just chilling out back in there. He said, "You guys want to go walk out? You can be careful." And we were at the torn up camp. And there's, you know, there's a waterway there. There's a corridor there. And you know, I told Brandon I wanted to walk over that little teeny mound over there and see what's over there. He's like, cool, man. So he's, you know, he's on the right side of me. We're walking real slow, got our lights down nice and low. All of a sudden, blameless. Just, I would explain it like this. A massive crash. Like wood on wood. We're talking like a big branch or something or some sort of log being thrown up against a tree, and you hear it. And I'm like, oh my God. And Brandon's Mr. Calm, Cool, and Collected. I mean, he's like one of the coolest guys out there. I mean, and the guy only carries a machete, you know? And he just looks at me, he goes, no, do you want to go up a little further? I said, no, Brandon, I don't want to go up. I said, I want to go back. He goes, just walk back slowly, man. So I walked backwards. I did not even turn around. And then as we're leaving, I heard like a, I went, oh man, this is crazy. So we get back to the car and Bob, you know, he tells us, he says, look, man, he said, let's just call it a night here. Because we don't want to press our luck. This is a corridor. This is where they come in. And, we just want to be safe. So that's one of the, instances where I was pretty frightened. Now, the other one was down at the Stubblefield Bridge. And I decided to spend the night there myself. As Tim and Bob were driving off, they were like, Mo, got a nice warm bed for you at my house. And Tim's like, you know, Mo, you can stay at my house. I'm like, no, guys, I'm going to stay here. I'm going to stay here all night. Because I could stay up all night. It's no biggie for me to stay up all night. So I'm down at the bridge, and I decided to cook up some fish on my little propane stove. And I was there alone. I had some light with me. And during the course of the evening, stones started being thrown at me from each side of the road. And every time I would walk down where a stone was thrown, a stone behind me would be thrown. So I would be going back and forth, with stones being thrown. I actually even have a mark on my vehicle where a stone hit my vehicle back near the tailgate. So I decided that I was just going to keep a vigil. I turned my recorder on, and what I got was something smacks the bridge, and you could hear it on the recorder. It's a large smack, almost like a hand hitting metal, or a fist hitting the metal bridge. And then I get a growl, and I get one of those log things thrown that crashes in the woods. And, you know, you call me crazy. But I stayed there all night, and those things were harassing me all night. I know that this was something other than, you know, people or a bear or what have you. It was large. It had to have hands to throw these stones. These stones were just being, you know, thrown at me. I mean, not, you know, just skipped across or kicked or whatever. Whatever was doing this was throwing them. And that night was very, very scary. But you know what? For some reason, I had courage enough to stay there all night. I was even talking to them. I mean, when I get nervous, I talk a lot. And I was like, you know, when I heard that crash in the woods, I said, okay, I'm moving. I'm going down here. I'm going to walk to the end of the bridge here. You know, I'm in your space. You know, it sounds crazy, but it almost, you know, it was like, you know, my way of coping with it.
Yeah, a way to comfort yourself.
Yeah, when you're by yourself. Now, I was armed. Okay, I won't say that much, but, I mean, if there's a whole bunch of them, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
You can only reload so fast, you know?
Right.
And then I told Bob about that, and he goes, you know, he's like, no, this is, if I was you, I would never go out by myself ever again.
Yeah.
You need a place to sleep. I got a couch. If everybody goes in, from now on, I got a couch. You can crash in my house. And ever since that night that it happened to us, I do not go out alone anymore.
And I don't recommend it. For anyone to go out alone. Why do you think he stayed there? Do you think you were just kind of curious? I know when it, sometimes when action starts happening, it's hard to walk away, but were you just curious? Were you, why do you think he stayed?
I was scared. I was curious. I was, at times I was pissed off because every time I walked into in this direction, I felt like they were screwing with me. That's what I felt like. Like it was like a game, you know, to see how they could just mess with me. I stayed there out of curiosity.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people listening to it will think, well, you know, it could have been people, that's a good way to get yourself shot in the middle of the night out there, you know, throwing rocks at someone could you hear them moving around?
Oh, every once in a while you would hear the brush popping in the background. And then there's a little island down by that stubble filled area. You would hear them in there too. And I constantly had my flashlight going, just looking for them. And, you know, I didn't have any thermal, nothing like that, just flashlights. And they could have been hiding behind trees for all I know. There were plenty of trees to hide behind. But I wasn't going to walk anywhere near where I heard sounds. I'll send you the audio from the bridge. I'll send it to you.
Yeah, I'd love to hear it. I laugh a little bit about Brandon. And for people listening, that's Bob's son. That guy is... the first time you were talking, I mean, guy carries around a machete, and the night that we were, I thought he was armed. I just thought the machete was just, you know, backup, but apparently he just carries a machete. We were out there, and that first night that we were there, and you could hear this thing just screaming and coming closer and closer and closer, and it wasn't. It sounded like a person screaming, coming right at us, but real deep. I mean, it obviously wasn't a person. You could tell by the vocals it wasn't a person, but and it's coming closer and closer and closer. And when Shannon and Mimi and I were out there in the forest, I flashed the flashlight over and I see Brandon. So I go over to Brandon and I'm like, hey, man, I think we should, I think we should head back to camp. And I go, because that Sasquatch sounds pissed off. And he goes, oh, it's a Sasquatch, all right. I'm not going to go back to camp, though. And, I mean, just cool, calm. And I remember seeing...
Isn't it amazing how cool he
is? Yeah, it's funny because Bob, Travis, and Brennan, they're all three just like that. And I'm like, my heart's racing. And I'm like, I think we should head back to camp. And I remember looking down, seeing his machete, and thinking, okay, well, he's armed. He probably has a gun on the other side. And then when we got back to camp, I was like, you just had a machete on you? You know, it's interesting that you went out there and you stayed. Isn't it fascinating how it kind of consumes you after a while, this talk? After you have something like this happen, it just kind of consumes you. You know what I mean?
Oh. Like you wouldn't believe it. Because, I mean, my thing is I want to prove that they're real. I want to get some proof just so people will know it and be aware. Because I look at the forest. Tracking, I look at it a lot differently now than I did before. You know, I never had any real fear of it before, but now I know. And one thing, getting back to Brandon, there was one time where Brandon was he got a little flustered, was when we were at that one area where you guys were, where you heard it crossing. Brandon and I, just for the heck of it, went down to the road there. And Brandon went about 100 yards from me, and we started doing owl calls back to each other, you know, back and forth. And then we started hearing owl calls at us, but they didn't sound exactly like the owl calls, like barred owls, you know, that I'm used to. So Brandon walks up my way, he comes up my way, he goes, Mo, you know, you may have a Sasquatch down there making those owl calls. And I said, really? So we walk down the road a little bit, and I do my my like almost like a gorilla, and about, oh my goodness, maybe 30 feet in front of us, there's an embankment, and we heard a growl, and it was a deep got a little pissed off growl. And that's when Brandon said, he looked at me and goes, Mo, he said, we gotta go. We gotta head back to the car. That's the only time I ever saw Brandon like that.
Yeah.
Any other time, he's cool and collected, but that time, he said, Mo, we gotta go. He says, that thing's mad. We're too close. When we get back to the vehicle, of course, Bob has his gun drawn, and he says, Mo, I'm telling you, stop messing with him, man. He said, you're in for a serious ass whooping. Don't mess with him. Don't make those sounds. So that's why when everybody asks me to make those sounds all the time, I'm very, very cautious to do it. I will do it in a very large group. You know, if there's a whole bunch of people there and everybody's armed. But if there's only one, two, maybe three of us, I'm not going to do it.
Yeah.
You know? So if anybody comes out with me, we're only in a group of three and they ask me to do it, I won't do it.
Yeah. And for people who don't understand that call that you do, sounds like, well, to me, it sounds like a Sasquatch, but if you don't believe in Sasquatch, the call that you do sounds like a pissed off gorilla. I mean, I'm serious. When you did it that first night, I was kind of scrambling for my gun at first. I was like, we're in trouble here. And I'm looking for my gun. I look over and I see you're the one that's doing it. I mean, it really took me off guard. I was like, wow, that's an amazing, amazing call. I've never heard anyone do anything like that. And I think it would piss them off. I think it would kind of bring them in.
Well, what I do is, Wes, is like if I'm with a whole bunch of people and we're at a camp, what I try to do is you've seen me walk the perimeter of the camp. You saw me go out by myself and walk that perimeter and listen and stuff. What I try to do is, I mean, and this just what I do, I mean, if everybody wants to criticize it, they can. But I sort of act like I am the alpha male of our group, the human alpha male. And what I do is I walk the perimeter and I make those noises like I'm protecting this camp. This is my group. I'm the leader of the group. I'm protecting the group. And that's the way I want them to interpret it. Like I'm not almost like, not like a challenge, but just like a vocalization saying, don't come into this camp. Well, when you do that, of course, to them, it is a challenge. I guess they take it as a challenge. And that's when I've gotten a lot of stuff back. Growls and howls and stuff thrown. That's why Bob said, you know, Mo, he says, you know, don't think you're communicating with them. You're just pissing them off. So that's why I'm very wary of doing it in small groups.
Right. And it makes sense. And, you know, like I said, the call that you do, it really took me off guard. You know, I wanted to ask you, there's a question something's been kind of bugging me. You know, the night that we were out there, there's a couple things I wanted to ask you about the East Texas area and kind of my take on it. And maybe I'm off. The first thing I'll say about the East Texas area, it's almost like they're all kind of crammed into spots. Do you know what I'm trying to say? It's almost like they are, the last night that we were out there, we were hearing stuff from all different directions, and it was all different types of sounds. Like, you'd hear the Ohio howl over here, and then you'd hear chatter over here, and then you'd hear, you know, a scream over here. And it just seemed like it was coming from every different direction. Do you think they're just, like, getting crammed in that area? I mean, do you think that is why you hear about all of the aggressive people coming up missing, all the, because I'll tell you right now, I think the Texas Sasquatch, they seem to be a lot more pissed off at the world than most places. Or maybe I just haven't been in a position where night after night after night after night, where you have these different experiences, they just seem to be more pissed there. And do you think it comes down to that they're getting crammed into like these corridors or getting crammed into these locations?
I think that's a possibility, Wes, because you understand there, you know, Houston area, I mean, years and years ago, had a lot of places for these things to go. There's a lot of land developments. I mean, you gotta remember the Woodlands years and years ago, it just it was just bad. It was a wooded area. And I think what you're talking about is being crammed in that area. I think maybe clans can overlap each other's territory. I think it's possible. I think it's possible they could be warning other clans, don't get too close. But what I think you were hearing was strategic calls and communication amongst them because we were there. I'll tell you right now, they don't like us there. And I think that's what you're hearing. All those calls were them strategically placed. The sentries that come out and check you out, call back to whoever, just let each one in the clan know exactly where they are. And they just move around and follow us. That's only 7 people. Is their territory being closed in? Yeah, with all the development going on, yes. But if you ask me about all those calls, I think they were just they were communicating with each other because there was a whole bunch of humans in their area.
And I guess that makes more sense. The area that we were at, it just seemed like it was going on all around us. And some of them kind of off in the distance, some of them kind of close. But it just seemed like Jurassic Park out there, man. That last night I was just like, every night I was like, this is unbelievable. One of the calls I wanted to ask you about, and this is another thing that's been bugging me. You remember the night I'm talking about before we found that track and we heard, I hate to say werewolf, I hate to use that term, but I mean, it sounded like a freaking werewolf going off. And do you remember the night I'm talking about? I think it was Wednesday night.
Yeah, I remember the night, and I remember hearing what I heard, yeah.
What was your, and for the audience, it basically sounded like, to me, and you might have a different take on it, Mo, I've just never heard anything like that before in my life. I've heard, through YouTube, through being out, I've heard the roaring, I've heard all sorts of vocals, but that one really threw me off. And, everyone that we were there with, they were like, oh, well, that's a Sasquatch. And I remember looking over at you and being like, I didn't want to say anything at the time, but I remember thinking, I don't think that's a Sasquatch. I mean, I've never heard anything like that before in my life. I mean, what do you think it was? Do you think it was a Sasquatch, or do you think it was a quote unquote type 3, what we call the dog man? And I hate using the term dog man, but what's your take on that sound that we heard?
Well, I'm gonna tell you right now that I heard it once before, and I think it's a squatch, but all I'm gonna say is this. I'm just gonna say that I believe it's a different type of squatch. And I'm just going to leave it at that, Wes.
No, I understand that.
I don't know if I can go into it or not. I just, it was a type of Sasquatch. That's all I can tell you.
Yeah. No, I mean, and feel free to go into it. I mean, and if you don't want to, that's okay. But I honestly, I've never heard anything like that. And then I think it was the next day we were out on almost in the direction that we heard that call. And I almost stepped on that track that we found. And I remember I was like, Mo, come over here and take a look at this. And I'm so glad I didn't step on it. I wish we would have been able to cast. Well, we couldn't have casted that week anyway. It was basically flooding. Too much rain. But that track, I've never seen a track like that before, man. I mean...
Did you see how it narrows? It narrows back towards the hill.
Yeah, it went back
almost, like a V fashion.
Exactly.
Back towards the hill. Yeah.
And yeah. I mean, I hope that's not what we heard that night. As soon as I saw that track, man, I was like, oh no, oh no. Do you think they're the different types in there are crossing paths? I mean, they have to be crossing paths through there.
I would say yes. I mean, I can't, of course, I can't be certain, but I would say yes. I would say maybe certain types of squatches are even, you know, trying to kill younger squatches that are different from them. And who knows? Eating them? I don't know. But, I definitely think that there is some sort of clash between these different types. And who knows, they could be hunting the regular squatches. I mean, it's just a theory that I have. I mean, I can't be certain about it. It's just a theory that I have. There's a lot of theories that I have. I could be dead wrong, you know, but it's just a theory that I have. But I very well possible that these different types are hunting the young or the other types.
Yeah, and it makes sense. You know, I mean, there's primates that hunt other primates. You know, you see it all the time with monkeys and chimps, and you see primates hunting each other and killing each other. And I'm telling you, man, that was just like Jurassic Park out there.
You know, when I first came down here, Wes, and I saw it, I couldn't believe it. I was like, this is Texas? You know, I'm going to see, you know, open fields with cows and, you know, maybe if you get into the San Houston National Forest with a big thing, you may see a couple of pine trees and stuff. But you're right, it's a totally different world. I mean, you know, you take somebody there and they're like, wait a second, this is East Texas? No way. Yeah. And even Shannon said that. She's like, wow, it's like a totally different world, man.
Yeah, it is. And it's not what I was expecting. I wasn't expecting the underbrush to be so thick. I wasn't expecting everything to be so thick out there. As far as hiding goes, you can hide out there just as well as you can in Washington State. I mean, it's just so thick. The underbrush is just so thick.
And when it comes to night vision, I mean, you know, that night vision isn't, you're not always going to make a capture with that night vision, you know? I also have a theory that these squatches can, you know, with two big sweeps of their hands or arms and hands, can dig a little area by a tree and just lay on their bellies. You know, that's very, very possible they can do that. So you'd have to actually get behind that tree in order to see it. And I actually used one of those night visions that you all had, and I did a little experiment like that. I mean, they were thick enough trees or wide enough trees that they could actually hide behind them, and you wouldn't be able to see them.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. You know, even the thermal, it was hard to see into some of the brush. Even with the thermal, it's hard to see anything. You know, night vision, thermal. It's nice to have, but you get in some of these areas and they're almost kind of useless because you just can't see into the brush. You know, you just can't see what is there. I wanted to ask you, I'm sure you have a million more encounters. Is there any other encounter that you wanted to bring up?
Well, I mean, you know, I've had encounters that you know, there's one, I don't want to say where it is, but it was with me and Bob and Tim, and it was kind of freaky. You know, we were tracking these things. We were following the pigs, and Bob even commented, said, you know, you follow the pigs, and that's where the squatches are. They're hunting the pigs. And this area was, talk about Jurassic. Wow. And Bob, the trooper that he is, we went in a long ways, me, him, and Tim, a long ways, and we tracked these things. We were tracking their traps. And Bob and I are at a washout at a creek, and we're inside the washout seeing what was scooping this washout out, and if we could see if any prints were in there. And we follow the tracks down from the washout, and then Tim has his holding his camera, and he says, hold on a second, man. Come up here and see what I'm seeing. And I'm like, what you got? He said, just come up here and look at what I'm looking at. So I get up there, and I said, okay, just point your finger. What do we got? He points his finger, and there you see it. I mean, and my glasses work. I got pretty good glasses. They work. I saw what I saw. There were two of them, and one of them, that was on the right side, was looking at the other one. Just kept constantly turning its head. And kids like, you see it turning its head? I'm like, yeah, I can see it, man. And they were like a brown color, but both of them, it was weird, both of them had a, like, blondish streak where you think their ears would be. Both of them had it. But one of them was just looking at the other one. And I did something, I guess you'd call it rather foolish, but I just wanted to see what they would do, if I could break its concentration of it looking at the other one. So I raised my hand up in the air, almost like over top of my head, and I sort of wave it real slow. And Bob's like, "No, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm trying to break its concentration." He's like, "You're going to break its concentration either way." Because it did it again, just kept looking at the other one, and then looking at us, looking at the other one, and looking at us. And that's when Bob went over to the left side, and he saw one over there flanking us over by a mound over there. And he's like, "Okay, guys, it's time to go. We got to go right now." And Tim and Bob are walking away. I'm just still standing there staring at these two things. And Bob's like, "No, let's go now. Let's go, man." And I'm like, "What the?" It's like, were these things stupid or what? Because all it did was just kept looking at the other one. I didn't understand what it was doing. I don't know from a strategic standpoint what it was doing. Was it trying to maybe get us to look its way while the other one was flanking us? I have no idea, but it just didn't look right. And then finally Bob said one more time, "Mo, let's pack it up." So we pack it up. We go same way back we went. And we get to this little, off the beaten path road that takes you out to the main road. And as we're walking, we're hearing them walking us out. Hearing them parallel us. There's, snaps, and Bob will stop and go, "Listen to that." And you'll hear a snap, crack, But here's the thing, Wes. In that area, you heard no vocals. They didn't make a sound. Not a growl, not a howl. Nothing. So I guess different ones act differently.
Was this during the day?
During the day, sure was. And Tim got, he had his camera up. I mean, he had it on the tripod and he's holding it up as best as he could to get it in view. And as we reviewed what Tim had, we're watching it on his computer, and I said, "Tim, look over to the right here." It was one over to the right. So there could have been four of them. So we could have been in serious danger. And Tim's like, "Yeah, I do see that one, and it actually moves." So you had the two in the background, you had one up a little closer to the right, and you had the one on the left that Bob saw.
Yeah, I really wish that you guys as a group, one thing I'll say about your group is, all you guys, Mo, like hanging out with you is like hanging out with my brother all week. I mean, I felt like I was with my brother all week, and I just love you guys to death. I wish that, and I kind of get it at this point, why you don't release some of the stuff, but I really wish you guys would release some of the videos that you guys have. Some of the stuff Sean was showing me, some of the stuff Tim was showing me. It was just, I was like, why isn't this available to anyone? Some of the stuff that you guys actually have. Yeah, but I get why you guys don't release it. But I was shocked at some of the stuff that you guys had. Do you think, in that encounter, the one that was facing you, do you think that was the alpha male, the one that kind of giving you guys the stare down? Was that an impression that that was kind of the alpha male, or do you think they were hanging out there so that they could flank you?
You're talking about the one that was turning its head. That's what you're talking about, or the one that Bob saw?
What, during your encounter, during the one you just told, wasn't there two of them? One that was looking dead on at you guys and the other one turning its head?
Yeah, there was one looking dead at us. Wasn't even looking at the other one, but the other one on the right hand side, which actually I'm looking at is on the left, but on the right hand side of the other one, just kept looking at that one. But they were the same size.
Oh, they were the same size.
Yeah, they're the same size, and they both had this touch of like blonde where you think their ears would be. It was weird. They're definitely weird looking, man. That's what I would say. I would just call them weird looking.
Yeah, how far away do you think you were when you saw them?
Oh, my goodness. I mean, I'd say maybe 85, 90 yards, maybe.
Did you get a chance to look at the face? I mean, did you get a chance to get a good look at their, really it's 85 to 100 yards. You may not get, you know, have a clear vision, yeah. But do you remember seeing the faces of them?
Well, I mean, again, it was, I mean, that was like 85, 90 yards, man. I mean, didn't get a clear look at their faces. You saw the outlines of them. You saw, I mean, you see the head, the shape of the head and everything. You could see that they were pretty big, but I didn't, you know, I couldn't tell you what color eyes they had. I couldn't tell you if they had a, you know, a baboon style nose, if they had a, you know, I couldn't tell you that. But I could tell you that they were brown, they were big, they moved, well, the one moves, and they had blonde or, you know, like, I don't know, blonde, yellow, whatever. In their fur, above their ears. That's the only thing I can tell you. I did not get a good look at the face. You know, it was more like an outline.
Yeah, when they're walking you out, it's almost as terrifying as seeing them. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean. I would have felt safer if I heard some sort of calls or some sort of, you know, yelps or whoops or something like that. I would have felt safer, but they didn't make a sound except for the, you know, the brush popping. You could hear something walking bipedally, walking us out. That was the scary part. But, you know, when you're out there, how people say don't show fear. Well, we sort of do that. We sort of keep it like, you know, we'll talk amongst ourselves very softly. We will look around and, you know, be cognizant of our surroundings, but it's not like, you know, we're on high alert. We know they're there. We just walk it out, you know, and that's what they were doing, walking us out.
Yeah, their behavior is pretty, it's so interesting to me. It makes me wonder if there's like crazy Sasquatches out there, or if some of them have like some sort of like mental deficiency or something. Because some of the encounters you hear, it's like, people are, you know, people get just short of attacked by them, you know, or attacked by them or killed by them. And then you have other behavior that's so strange. You know, the night that Bob and I were out there, and I started realizing really quick that wasn't a person walking. That thing's hauling. I mean, it probably was just walking for them, but it, you know, and the way it walked, you know, in that whole area, I know there was more than one, because we walked away from the noise that night. And I remember it was almost as terrifying as seeing them, because you can't see them. You could hear them. And where the log came from wasn't the same one, or I'm assuming wasn't the same one where we walked in. But that thing walked us all the way back up to the main trail, and then it stopped and we just walked out. But it's just terrifying as you walk and you hear them just kind of walking you out. You know, it's, I don't even know what to say. It makes you wonder how many was there, you know, during that, while you guys were out there. Was Bob afraid because it was flanking you guys? Was that kind of why he was like, hey, it's time to go?
Oh, yeah. He, I mean, you know, Bob knows his stuff. And, you know, I mean, looking at that video where we saw that one a little closer behind a tree, and it was moving a little bit. And then Bob saw the one on the left. Bob was, you know, get on, you know, let's go now, because we're going to get an ass whooping. And, you know, I trust Bob. Bob knows his stuff. Bob's the best there is, in my opinion. And when Bob says, let's go, let's get out of here, from now on, I'm not going to be lollygagging or you know, staring or whenever he says that, I'm gonna listen to him. Just like the night when you guys were out there, and Bob says, you know what? No, I don't think you should go back in there. And we didn't. Remember, we walked on the road, and then we get back, and Bob is taking you guys in, and that's when you got the log thrown at you. See, Bob, he gets stuff thrown at him all the time. I get the sounds. I get the growls. I get the hollers. I mean, I'll occasionally get, you know, stuff thrown, but majority of the time, I start getting vocals. Bob gets stuff thrown at him.
Yeah, and it's funny because for a lot of people who might hear that, go, oh, come on, he gets stuff thrown at him all the time. I'm telling you, people, I was there. And the log that got thrown at us was this huge, huge log. And I thought it was going to take one of our heads off. I thought for sure it was going to hit us in the head. And it hit the tree right in front of us. And, you know, that's something I was terrified. I was like, you know, I was kind of looking over at Bob, and I was just like, oh, my eyes are, you know, the size of saucers. And Bob just calmly looks at me and goes, hey, so where was that track that you and Mo found the other day? Was it right around this area? And I was just like, you know, this guy's seen some stuff, because I was blown away. I just looked at him. I was like, what? And he goes, yeah, was that track? Do you think it was right in this area? Because I don't think we should go down there where that log was running, but was it around here? And I'm just like, this guy's having a conversation like it's Monday morning and we're sitting around drinking coffee. And I'm like, I can feel my heart in my throat, you know? And I'm just like, I couldn't believe it.
That's what I'm learning from Bob, Wes. That's what I'm learning from him. When stuff like that happens, to be calm, to be, you know, collect yourself and don't freak out. That's what I'm learning from him. And I mean, it's good advice. You know, you got that thing thrown at you. I mean, you could have ran. I mean, you guys could have, you know, if you had weapons, immediately draw your weapons, whatever. But Bob is cool like that. He'll just, you know, he takes it for what it is. It's a warning. It's just, you know, don't show the fear. Don't show that you're upset. And just, quietly walk out of there. Now, the next day we came there, Wes, we saw a log right there. We saw that log. It was right there by the tree. Was that the log? I don't know. It wasn't like it was a log that was sitting there for days. It was, you know, a log that was right by that tree there. And then when Shannon and I went around to where, you know, we could look at where you guys were standing there during the day, where the log was, there was a small little, there was an indentation behind the tree. Almost like it was dug out and pine needles placed on top of that little dugout area behind the tree. And I think Shannon has a picture of it. She got a picture of it. I didn't, but, you know, strategically I was looking at it. I'm like, yeah, I can see where this thing threw that at you. I can see exactly where he threw it. And they're so daggone strong, man, that they can whiz these things, you know, like they're little twigs.
I don't know, man. I had an amazing time. I had an amazing time down there. I just love you, all you guys, to death. And I can't thank you enough for taking the week to show us around. And you know, it's freaking Jurassic Park down there. It's no joke. And you're right. I mean, and I'll give you credit too, Mo. Not just Bob. Bob is, I learned a lot from Bob in the very short amount of time I was there. I would say one of the biggest things I picked up from Bob, and actually all of you guys, is you guys are trackers. You guys will actually go in and track. It's not, you know, you guys are actually going in and tracking and finding out, you know, even with you, Mo, you're like, hey, look, they probably came through here. And you were dead on with where it came through the next day when we went up and we were walking through where that one had crossed the road and eventually threw the log at us. But it's exactly where it came through. And you could see the brush. It looked like, you know, something drove through there and almost, I mean, you almost nailed the path that it came, and you could tell something large that went through there. You know, the log in the road has always bothered me on why they do that sort of thing. If that's a, hey, I don't want you to leave, or it's going to be hard for you to leave, or it's going to, because I've experienced that a few times where, you know, Woody and I, when we went up to Yakult and we had just driven down a road, and then on our way back, also now there's a log sitting in the middle of the road, and there's not an area where it would have fell from. It's like the log was placed there. That night out there in Texas, as we're leaving, it's like it had thrown this log across the road and it had kind of busted up, but there was really no place for it to come from. and there's just this log in the road kind of blocking our path from leaving. It's just, it's terrifying to say the least when you see something like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, they could have just done it because they were pissed off. I mean, you'd think, you know, maybe they threw it out there to try and block the road. I mean, maybe. But I just think that, I mean, they're animals. They're an intelligent animal. But they also get pissed off, you know. They're emotional just like us. You know, some of them freak out sometimes when you hear them, you know, doing that chimp stomp and that, you know, those monkey chatter and stuff, that was monkey sounds. I mean, they get pissed off, and I think maybe that's what it was. The thing just got pissed off and just decided to do that. I don't think it was trying to block our path. I just think that, you know, it was angry. And, you know, that area there that you saw that I showed you, that's where they constantly cross. In and out of there. That's where they come across, right there. And you know, back in there, there's a lot of pigs back in there, and that's where they love to hunt those pigs, back in there, too. So, I mean, who knows? We could have been there, and we could have interrupted their hunt. And that's, you know, that's why maybe they threw a log at you, because you were screwing up their hunt. I mean, who knows? I mean, could be.
Yeah.
No, I don't know. But anything's possible. Getting back to that area, you heard what Bob said. He says, listen, man, you guys can just sit right here. You can sit right here, and you're going to hear a whole bunch of stuff. And I've done that by myself. Yeah. I've actually, you know, I'll still go out when I come in the morning. I mean, I'll put my dash cam on, and I'll come in by myself, but I'll sit in my vehicle. I won't get out anymore. I'll walk by myself, but I'll sit in my vehicle. Wes, I'll roll my windows down, and I'll put the recorder on, and I'll get some serious sounds. Just sitting right there.
Yeah, you could get out, and you're right. You could get hours and hours and hours of vocals just sitting there in that spot. The last night we were there, you know, I was just like, man, I hope the recorder's picking this up, because it was just coming from every direction. But going back to what you're saying, where they had crossed the road right there, I don't know if you heard it the other night on the podcast, Dave talking about the one he saw cross. And it's funny because that night we were all kind of sitting around the car, and I was actually in the driver's seat, and he was in the back passenger seat, and I think Shannon was in the back seat, and we were just kind of congregating around the car, and we hear these vocals just going off. I mean, you could just hear these things just going off in the background. And some of the things I was hearing, I was like, wow, this is amazing. We're all trying to be quiet. And then Dave starts going, Oh, and I look back at him, and I'm like, Dave, you know, try and be quiet, man. Right, you know, but I noticed he wasn't looking the same direction as everyone else was looking. He was actually looking at that spot where we heard that thing cross. We said they crossed the road. Bob said they heard cross the road. Where Bob says they crossed the road, and then where Bob and I heard it cross the road right there. You know, he's sitting with his night vision. And it's funny because we're all out there doing this. You would think if you see something, this would be a great time to bring it up. And he was kind of shook up. It was hard to get him to talk about what he saw. He was like, hey, I don't want everyone to think I'm crazy. I don't want it. And I'm like, really? This isn't The Office, man. Like, we're all hearing this. But it's this mentality of when you see something, you're afraid to say something because you don't want people to go, oh, you're full of crap. Or he's like, yeah, I don't want you guys to think I was crazy. Or he's like, why would you think we thought you were crazy, man? I mean, could you hear what's going on around us? But it's just amazing when someone has an encounter that there's that feeling of like, maybe I shouldn't say anything. You know what I mean? But it was right in that spot. It was right there in that spot. And he had his night vision up, and he was, I mean, I could tell it was reacting to something.
I had left, remember?
Yeah.
And that's the night, right? The night that I left like about 7:45, something like that. And that's the night that he saw it?
That was the night he saw it, yeah. It had actually cleared up that night. The stars were out. It was a really nice night that.
Wait a second. Are you sure the stars were out? You sure?
Yeah.
Just giving you some shit. That's, yeah, I can't, see, and that's another thing that I mean, you know, you could have sightings on a rainy night and stuff, but I think that they happen more so when it's clear out. I mean, you know, again, I could be wrong about that, but that's only me. When it's, you know, clear and there's stars out and stuff and it's a decent night, that's when I get the majority of this stuff. But Tim, you know, pulled up into a camp and it's been raining and Tim has had a sighting. So, you know, we can go both ways, I guess.
And I will tell you, that night that we were there that cleared up, because it had been raining all week, but that night where it actually had cleared up, there were a ton of vocals, man, way more than any other night that we were there. And I don't know if it's because of the weather or whatnot, but, I mean, there was way more vocals that last night that we were there. And it was just terrifying, exciting. You guys are the real deal, and Texas is—it's no joke, man. You know, I was laughing when I came back because, you know, there's so many things in Texas beyond a Sasquatch that will kill you. It seems like everything out in that forest will kill you. Even some of, yeah, I mean, it's just everything will kill you out there.
Here's one thing I wanted to ask you, Wes.
The recording
that I let you listen to, which I call it, I mean, I just named the file Monkey Talk. You listen to it. Have you ever heard anything like that out in the forest in your life?
No.
I listen to it. Every day I listen to it. And I'm trying to, you know, try to process it. And a lot of people that I've let listen to it say they've heard that before when they've had activity. And I mean, it's not your typical scream. It's like communication. That's what I would classify it as. There was two of them communicating. You know, and here we are at a campfire, just us guys talking, and my recorder's about 120 yards away from us, and I pick this stuff up, this communication between them. And it's, I'm also going to send you that, you know, I'm going to send that to you. I want you to have it. You're pretty good on Audacity. I'm pretty new to Audacity, and I want to see if you can clean it up a little bit better and maybe make it sound a little louder or clearer. You know? Yeah, what did you think of when you heard it, when I played it for you on my little Samsung-powered speaker?
I was kind of shocked when I heard it, to be honest with you. I it was clear. I've never heard anything like that before in the forest, period. I just haven't. But all week long, there was stuff I've just never heard. But what you have is really, really clear, really, really clear. And if you didn't believe in Sasquatch, what else is that? You know what I mean? When you listen to that, it's like, well, what else could this be? It's shocking to hear some of the stuff, you know, even out there. I was saying this to Shannon today. I was talking to Shannon earlier today. We were talking about Texas and among other things, but her and I just had that conversation. I said, you know, Shannon, if you didn't believe that Sasquatch exists and thought it was complete BS, go out there with you guys out there at night and you will hear stuff you've never heard before in your life. And when I say Jurassic Park, I'm not joking. It's like freaking Jurassic Park out there. Even that night that you and I went out, Mo, and there was the chatter we could hear off in the distance. I mean, it's just nonstop out there, man. It's freaking nonstop out there. I was completely shocked. I would love to take a skeptic. Not even. No, I take that back. I don't mind skeptics. I would like to take a debunker out there and just spend a couple nights out there. And see what they have to say afterwards. Because I can guarantee if they're not running back for their car and trying to get the hell out of there, and it's no joke. I mean, I've never heard anything. I mean, I don't even know what to say, man. I don't even know what to say. I would love to take a debunker out there, especially around to that torn up camp area or some of the other areas that you guys took us, and just say, hey, why don't you hang out here for the night? And we'll be back in the morning to pick you up.
Imagine if, I mean, we all could do this full time out in that area. Imagine doing it every single day. You didn't have a, just say you were retired, okay? You didn't have a job, didn't have bills to pay, and you could just go out and do this every day. Imagine what you, the possibilities, what you could get, you know? See, I go out, you know, I don't go out too often anymore. I mean, I don't have the chance to. I'm so busy. But when I do get out, I try to get like 2 days if I can. But imagine doing this on a constant basis, you know?
Yeah.
At least 5 days a week. It's amazing what you would get.
You know, my only recommendation, TMO, would be to go ahead and start a Bigfoot podcast and then take your $70,000 rig and go out there and hang out for the week.
Oh, yeah. Maybe I can make about $30,000 a month. What do you think, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And you don't need to buy kindling. You can just use your money and just use that to burn at night to keep warm.
Exactly. And I just wanted to say to your audience that, you know, I'm a very good judge of character. Wes and his group, Shannon, his girlfriend Mimi, and everybody else, just stand-up people. You guys are just, you know, I mean, like I said, I'm a good judge of character. I know people. I can read people. You guys are just straightforward, honest, and what's being said is, you know, it's just a damn shame, man. It's like junior high stuff. And it, hopefully, you know, it'll go away soon enough and, just get back to doing what you do. And you don't have to worry about it, man. And, I wish you guys the best. And anytime you guys ever want to come out and I'm free, I'll take you guys off. No problem.
I appreciate it, man. That means more to me than you realize. And the feeling's mutual, man. It really is. Like I said, you're like hanging out with, you're like a version of Woody, maybe not quite as annoying as Woody.
But I felt like that again.
I said, you're like, hanging out with you is like, hanging out with, my brother, except for you're a less annoying version of him. You're like, just like hanging out with my brother, man. I mean, I think the world of you, and I think the world of all those guys, Bob, Sean, Tim, all those guys, man. I just think the world of you guys, and I appreciate you guys taking us out, and I appreciate you showing us around. And
and Wes, the feeling is very mutual, man. Very, very mutual.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yep. I appreciate it very much. Well, I appreciate you coming on, man, very much. I know it's been, I've been putting you off and putting you off and putting you off, but I really do appreciate you coming on, Mo, and I appreciate all the support to you, man, very much.
Hey, man, no problem, Wes. Anytime, like I said, you guys want to come back to East Texas, and I'm free to take you guys out. Bob put his trust in me. You know, he said, I know you can take him out, Mo, and show him around, and, you know, I'm glad I could do that. And Bob even, he gave me kudos, said you did a good job, Mo, and I hope I did.
You did. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like I said, the whole trip, the funnest part was hanging out with you, and I just can't thank you enough.
Well, anytime, Wes, anytime you guys want to come back out and I'm free, I'll take you guys back out. No problem.